steps to the door of your heart. Only shadows ahead, barely clear in the room. Get to know the feeling of liberation and release. Hey now, don't dream.
Well, just as we thought 2020 couldn't get weird enough, here I am doing this. At least I put on my good shoes. My arms are hard from what I do all day. And it's all for you, all for you.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us only sky. Imagine all. Nothing to kill or die for. No religion. Brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will be as one.
Simple to be a thousand words, okay. And I think we might, you might start with a few words, Ms. Alex. We're very pleased to be here today. Here are a few words.
There is something incredibly special about the bond between a grandparent and a grandchild. It's a precious parcel filled with joy, fun, mischief, and a little bit of magic, all wrapped up in the greatest of love. There's no doubt that Pop shared this with all of his 7 grandchildren and was even lucky enough to enjoy it with his 3 great-grandchildren. I'd like to share with you a little poem that I wrote called Through the Eyes of a Grandchild. There was 9 in the bed, and the oldest one said, "Riddly, riddly, ree," while holding a scotchie and a cup of tea. Those mornings were magic, many a yarn was told, your smile always so bright with that sparkling tooth of gold. And over the years, those stories never lost their luster, especially the one where the cat's head busted. All your grandchildren idolised you through the years this amplified, and there's certainly no denying that we were the apple of your eye. My dear old Pop, you were one of a kind, a witty man with the sharpest of minds. If I close my eyes now, I can still hear your laugh after you'd pull us in tight for a wet potty calf. Or the pride on your face when the whole family was together, I knew it was those times that you most treasured. You see, one of the greatest things you taught us is your legacy. The gift you left behind is the closest of families. So for now, my dear Pop, it's time to say goodbye, but we'll think of you each time we look up at the stars in the sky.
Now, Pop wasn't the biggest fan of technology and has probably never heard of YouTube, so the fact that his funeral is being live-streamed makes me giggle a bit. Sorry, Pop, but how's the irony? Maury Popper, I'm so proud to call you my Pop and so grateful to be your favourite grandchild. I'm so grateful for the many years of family holidays, from Moana to Manly and to the infamous Bali trip. And for those wondering, Pop hated Bali and probably the food even more. I think his face was permanently unimpressed and continually shaking his head in disgust. I'm so grateful for the many cups of tea sitting outside with Nana's homemade biscuits and chocolate slice. I'm grateful for his visits up to the farm, which should have taken someone 10 minutes, but would have taken Pop 20 minutes because he drives so damn slow. I'm so grateful for the 20 years playing netball for Yankalilla and seeing his car always parked along the fence, rarely missing a home game of netball and footy. I'm so grateful for the many sleepovers we had as young children and the fun and bond we would share as cousins, siblings, and grandparents. I'm grateful for watching a beautiful marriage between Nana and Pop. I don't have any regrets when it comes to Pop because as a family, we all made the effort to spend time with you, not because we felt we had to, but because we loved being around you. I'm so lucky and grateful for the best Pop for the past 27 years of my life and always ending our phone calls or visits with a hug and a kiss and I love you. I will miss making fun of you because you barrack for the Crows and saying, oh bullshit, Beryl. I will miss the ridiculous and ever so politically incorrect comments. And I will miss watching you shuffle around like you have glue stuck to your shoes. But most of all, I will miss that happy face with the big gold tooth smile. I promise we will look after Nana and shower her with all the love and support she deserves. We love you, Pop.
Welcome everyone, I'm number one daughter Deb, and I'd like to thank you all for joining us here today to remember and celebrate Dad's wonderful life. It's a bit of a story, I've got a story to tell of his life, his history. Dad was born at Woodner Hospital on the 26th of June 1932. His parents, Amelia, alias Queenie, and Don Fitzgerald had five children, Kevin, Max, Rhonda, Neva, with Dad being the youngest. He spent his childhood on the family farm at Kynecutter on the west coast and went to school at Pallaby and then they went to Capicoola. The five siblings drove a horse and cart to school and they used to pick up the one and only teacher along the way. One morning the school teacher was running late and jogging down the road to catch his ride. The kids made out not to see him and kept going. And it took the teacher well over an hour to walk to school. The whole school had an extra playtime of an hour. I think the Fitzy kids would have been a pretty popular that day with their mates, but certainly they weren't with the teacher. Dad left school and moved to Adelaide, living with an uncle at Goodwood, and worked in a Chrysler car factory at Ashford, putting windscreens in cars. He then went back to the west coast to Cummins and worked on a relative's farm before his mum and dad sold the farm at Kynecutter and bought a small acreage vineyard at Pimpala at Morford Vale, which is now Fast Food Corner. During 1950, his parents sold the vineyard and bought the property at Waddle Flat. Dad worked on the farm known as Clover Glen with his brother Kevin and father milking Jersey cows. Dad soon made friends within the Yankalilla district, and he soon got his eye on Mum. There was a dance somewhere in the area every Saturday night. One night, all the Yank crew were at a dance at Victor Harbour, and Mum was getting a ride home to Yank with someone else. Dad told her, no good going home with them, they've got a flat tyre. I'll give you a lift home. And there it blossomed, the old flat tyre trick. Dad told his parents he was seeing a girl who works in Mitchell Servewell store in Yankalilla. The girl with two holes in her cheeks. Those beautiful deep dimples certainly proved to be a winner. Mum and Dad's wonderful life together of 63 years married began on the 6th of April 1957. They bought a home opposite Yankalilla area school and started a family having four children, before shifting up to the farm at Waddle Flat in 1966 when Dad's parents retired. Dad and Mum ran the dairy. Life was very busy, running the farm and bringing up four children, running us around everywhere to sport and school functions. Dad's love for horses saw him start breeding and training racehorses. He also had the vision to diversify and start Fitzgerald Quarries. Mum and Dad moved to Normanville in January 92 and Paul and Kerry moved to the Clover Glen farm. Dad and Mum stayed involved in the business for a few years before retiring. In retirement, they bought a caravan and had lots of wonderful trips throughout Australia. They loved hooking on the van, heading away with a group of bowlers every year to different states playing in the meat traders competition with the Stones, the Walterses, the Rosenbooms, the Jameses, the Lunnies, the Fretwells, the Hills, the Bowyers. There was lots of fun had there, I'm sure, around the caravan. Dad enjoyed playing bowls for Yankalilla, especially having a few beers afterwards. Pretty sure we all got some genes there. Mum and Dad also enjoyed going to the races where they made many lifetime friends. Dad loved his Crows. With season tickets, he ventured to Footy Park for years with Johnny Stone, Billy Pryor, Ray Clark, Jan Rosenboom and Mark Moffy Moffat. As a family, we enjoyed some great family holidays. It was like the Griswolds on vacation. So many laughs. We went to Fiji, Bali, Sydney for the New Year fireworks with Auntie Neve and Cousin Lise. Hired holiday homes at Middleton, Moana and Aldinga. We grew from three generations to four. Did every adventure together and always had an absolute ball. Dad was very proud of his garden and lawns. He enjoyed hours pottering around outside, perfecting each garden bed and getting his lawn greener than green. I'm going to miss popping in and seeing him sitting in his chair out the back, admiring his work, often having a cuppa. Dad was a true family man. The love and friendship Mum and Dad shared was very, very special. The four of us and our partners, seven grandchildren, Tani, three great-grandchildren, he just cherished and loved. We were the love of his life. We have lost the biggest golden link in our family, Chain. The sadness of losing this link will live for us daily. There will always be a gap which will remind us of that beautiful smile, charm, wit, respect for others and his amazing memory. Sitting you with you, Dad, during those last days, we spoke of things that will stay with me forever. You're an amazing father-in-law and mate to Jack. So love Pop to Michelle, Matt and Tani, and a proud great Pop of Hunter, Taylor and Ava. I am so privileged and proud to be able to call you my dad. I love you, Dad. Thank you.
Hi. Well, I'm number two daughter, Chris, but I think I was number one. Look, I think I just want to reiterate what Deb, well, I'm going to repeat some of those things because they're so important. Dad's highest priority was his family. But he was also a practical man who knew how to teach. He helped us solve problems. He set us challenges and let us have experiences and gave us opportunities that have shaped us to be who we are today as his children. He loved storytelling. He was always connecting family and history, and he never forgot a date, a name, a place, and he could even tell you what people were wearing, even if it was 40 years ago. He had an exceptional memory. But he also lived out his passion, and that was to breed and train racehorses. And he did this on top of running the dairy. Again, the horses brought us together as a family because, of course, he involved all of us in that and we all loved it too. And the legacy of that continues today. There was nothing like going to the races. The tension of getting there, getting dressed, getting ready, getting a horse load and getting there was just unbelievable. And then we all had our jobs at the track. Us kids minded the horses and helped saddle up. And Mum, she probably had the hardest job of all because she had to go and put the bets on. And she had always got very careful instructions on when to place a bet, to wait, to go early, to go last thing, to watch what so-and-so bookie was doing or so-and-so in the ring. And I think she had the highest pressure job. But after she'd put her bets on and the horses out in the track, we'd all gather in the grandstands together. And there was nothing like that adrenaline rush, all being there together barracking, almost riding those horses together to the line. And gee, it was special when they won. Really special. It was nothing like it. We're all there together. In finishing, over the past week, so many people have said to us all so many beautiful things about Murray that reflect what we all know. He loved Beryl and he loved his family. He was a true gentleman. He was a real horseman. He could chat to anyone, make them laugh. And most of all, that he was just a real beauty. He was one of a kind. And he's left amazing memories in our life, and they'll never go. And our heart will be filled. We love Murray.
Okay, I'm Paul. I'm the oldest son, probably the hardest working one of the family. Always have been. To my dear Cooter, Cooter Feedies, Murray Dad. I'm going to touch on now Dad on the farming and the quarry business. We all learned at a very young age a good work ethic at home with Mum and Dad, whether it be feeding calves, milking cows or driving machinery at a very young age. One of my first memories with Dad was, I was probably only about 8 or 9 years old up at the dairy. And my job was to go out and watch the bull at mating time. I had no idea what I was doing and I still don't. This was Dad's first birds and the bees lessons for you, Paul. I don't know what I'd witnessed or anything, I still don't. All I had to do was go in and tell him when the bull jumped up on the cow, give a bit of a heave, and then fell back down again, go in and tell Dad that the bull's just done what I had to watch. And then he'd go out and separate them. So that was it. I don't know what I was watching. I don't got no idea. Dad's love for the farm, he always loved his oats. Whether we grew all our own hay because we were self-sufficient that way, and we brought our grain in. I was never sure whether we bought it in for the dairy or it was for the horses. I suppose it was for the horses. We used to hammer mill our own hay and mix all our own cow feed at home. That lasted all the time. We'd have to hammer mill it and bag it off, bag the grain off, bag the hay off, whatever, and then mix it all up by a shovel each day in the up the dairy. He liked that tradition. Dad had Jerseys for probably 30 years. We milked constantly around 70 cows. In the mid-1970s, Dad came up with a new breeding plan. We went and bought a Friesian bull. Well, I was only a little chap then. Went and bought a Friesian bull from Royce and Wendy Bowie. It was a Linmac bull, bloodlines. So Dad mated the Friesian bull over the Jersey's cows, and we had a first cross. They were fantastic cows. As I remember, as all as kids, we used to name them from the actresses or whatever of Prisoner and Sullivan's and whatever. We had a Lizzie Birdsworth and, I don't know, Vera, old Vinegar. Anyway, in 1978, I left school. That disappointed me, leaving school. I really loved school. Dad was under the pump. He was in his 50s. He had 2 racehorses on the go. He still had all the farm to look after, the tractor work, etc., feeding animals, but it was hard going for him, and I could see the writing on the wall, so it didn't bother me too much. Then at about mid-90s, so he milked away. Then at about the mid-1980s, Craig had a job at Hiscol, which is the local dairy improvement centre. So in Dad's ways, we all got together. We decided then to do away with the bulls, and we started AIing the dairy cows. Dad encouraged us to do things like this. This was his program to push us along further, and we did. Craig did a great job of that, and we had a great Friesian herd then. We turned into it. But milking cows and racing horses and watching quarry contractors drive up and down the road got to us for a while, Dad and I. So we decided we'd get a share farmer. And then that way we joined up with our neighbour, a fella called Alan Hinks, and he milked the cows up at his place, which gave Dad more time with his horses. and we were just running cattle. But this was the time where we started the old MDBJ and PM partnership. We bought our first truck for the quarry and away we went from there. For years later, we were getting busier and busier with the quarry. It was great. We sold off the herd then, half the herd, and then we made it. We went into a program called a beefalo. We bred this cattle called beefalo. So the beefalo was a modern version of the buffalo. And the meat we got from these offspring, we sold to Sydney and Melbourne restaurants, etc. But then it got a bit difficult in the end, so we got out of that. We lasted a couple, it was a bit hard to run from Yankeelilla, so that was that job done. In 1992, the quarry was going really well. We was on our third truck by now, and we needed a machine to size a different size rubble of the quarry. So we sat down, Mum and Dad and myself, and we decided we needed to get a screening plant. So it was Kerry and I took off up to Queensland. So we bought, I found a plant up there, and Dad said, you know, look, great, if it's what you think we need, Paul, get it. To spur things along a bit, and he did. We missed out on a few jobs. As soon as we got this job, we won a great contract job with the council. It was fantastic on supply of material. That really set us up then, and then we won a couple more after that. So for the next few years, it was Dad and myself up at the quarry. We had two loaders, one with a cab and one without. Guess which one Dad was on? None of them, no. No, he was on the one without the cab. Anyway, one day we was up there. This went on for quite a few months because we made quite a few thousand tonne. One day he said to me, he said, look, I'm getting a bit sick of that load. I'm getting sunburned. Oh, well, what do you want to do? Oh, well, we made a frame up. So we made a frame up, I think Craig Hill was there. We made a frame up and we hung some old carpet over it. On the lid, whatever. That was good. He didn't get sunburned. About a week later, he said, I'm getting the carpet, when it rains, the water drips on my head. What are you going to do about that? No. Paul. He never called me Norm. Paul. All right, eh? Well, we come up with a big part, and then we went and bought a 50-cent tarp, I suppose, and we put this tarp over the top of the carpet. That was real good. About a week later, oh, geez, I'm sick of that tarp. It's flapping. It's noisy. I don't like that bloody flapping. So anyway, we put up with that. Also, at the same time, we bought a small tip truck, and Dad started driving this little tipper around town. So he'd do deliveries of building products or whatever all over the Fluorio. And he used to tell us that he had his own special customers that only he could go to because he said us young fellas didn't know how to drive the truck properly. All right, fair enough. 1994 we're up to now. Kerry and I bought the quarry business from Mum and Dad. And they semi-retired, but Dad still came up all the time. He had to. He loved it. Because one thing on the farm we had was baling twine. Dad loved his baling twine, bit of rubber tube, bit of barbed wire or plain wire. All you need extra is a pocket knife and a pair of pliers. If he'd had these things early in March, he could have solved the coronavirus crisis quite easily. That's the way he was. Everywhere you looked, there was a bit of string somewhere holding something with a bit of rubber and a bit of wire holding that down. They're still there now. And then anyone can vouch for if he used to go to his house and see his tomato pots. Well, his pots, he had Jack making him up cyclone wire. We had some with bolts to hold the wire off the tomato because the wire got too hot, it had burned the leaves on the tomatoes. Then we put wheels on them so he could shift them from one side of the house to the other because they'd get too much sun one side and too much wind on the other, so he'd have to push them around. He'd push them around all day. That was he loved it. He gave us kids plenty of chances, Dad. And if we did mess up, he'd just have a quiet talk about it and more or less try not to do it again. We had a few chances, but probably Debbie got about 50, actually. We didn't. Slowing down now, Dad also was an animal lover. He loved any animal. Any animal that had a personality, reliability, or had a bit of grunt to it, was a bit uncanny or something like that, Dad had taken under his wing and he loved it. Dad had his own cemetery and it's still there to this day between our house and where Matt James lives now. We got some good horses buried over there, a bull even, I know that, some really good dogs and some stupid dogs as well. And if they were any good, this animal that they buried, Dad would always plant a tree on them. Mainly blue gums and some chewed gums and whatever. There's still trees on the farm now. There's where old Rick died and that, but he got over by the dairy because he was a good work dog. He didn't get to the sand hill, that one. But that was Dad. He loved animals, wild cats, anything. He'd feed them milk, and even though they couldn't see the milk, he thought they were drinking it, but I don't know what was happening to them. Closing now, I'm going to miss our racing trips we did with Dad for years. Whether we were going to Adelaide or Melbourne, the Cox Plate night meetings or whatever. And some of them trips we had coming home with Louie and Ooge and Craig and myself and poor old Brad Summers driving. You know, we were going to leave at 5 o'clock. Well, Brad would be waiting in the car. We might leave at 7:30 to come home. Or, you know, get there at 7 and we'd leave at 9. They were some bloody good fun times and some wild times, but there's some great memories for many, many years. So there's one thing we're going to do, I want Dad to do for me when you get up them pearly gates. I want him to start a yodeling competition. As we all know, he could yodel, so once he starts that yodeling competition, we'll know he's up there. God bless you all, mate. I love you.
I wasn't the hardest worker, but I was the favourite. Before I get started, I just have to thank you, Father Bob, for today. It's pretty special for us to have you here today to run this in. And we just absolutely loved it. Thank you very, very much. I'm going to just touch on, so you're going to have to bear with me, a few of the emotional things with Dad, as far as a few of the sharing things, so bear with me. I just want to do you proud, Dad, because I was so damn proud of him. He, as Norm said, he just inspired us to do things in his own way, and you sort of reflect on it now. Now I know what he was doing. For me to personally to take on that job with Americans doing the artificial breeding, like I was way out of my level, but he just pushed me and said, "You'll be right, son. You'll be right. You keep at it. You'll grow with it." To going on to the farm, back to the farm with Paul and Murray and the landscape and business and now the transport business, all those things he just kept pushing along. One of the times I was lucky enough to be with Dad a lot of the last 6 weeks because of the COVID situation. There was only a couple of us allowed in, and there was one stage there, and I sort of medications and doctors and all this, and I sort of looked at him and said, "Dad, I could probably be a doctor." And he looked at me and says, "Well, I didn't stop you." Just as quick as. Looking back now, like his strength, I don't think we ever really knew. Well, Mum, you would have known, but kids growing up, we just expect Dad to be strong. But, wow, he was strong. To go through, and this is hard, but to go through what Dad went through, those last 6 weeks to get through a heart attack and a popped hernia, double pneumonia, cirrhosis of the liver, full renal failure. It's just, as the doctor said, any two of those, a person of that age is not here. He lived through every single one of them, and then he decided to go on his terms when he was ready. So each of us we were very, very lucky, really lucky. We had the opportunity, not a lot of families get where they're able to have good long chats, all of us except Katie and you, Megan. That was tough for all of us, but it was such a special time. All of us had that opportunity to talk through it with him and tell him how much we loved him. And he was just so, he wasn't steely, but I've seen a few of those chats and we're blubbering, we're crying, and he was just looking at us, just staring straight, knew exactly what we were going through, but he was the strength in every one of those conversations. He was amazing, and that's why the last big reunion on the West Coast, he was named Fitzy of all Fitzies.
That's a lot of
Fitzies. That's a lot of bloody Fitzies. It's a hell of a lot, and probably the best award you can get for us. As Norm's saying, we went to countless luncheons, race days, functions, and never had to look after him. He'd always find his own people, his own conversations. They were magnificent days. Well, did have to look after him one day when he thought someone spiked his wine, but he just had too much. He wasn't a big wine drinker, but he loved it there. Perhaps another day, or many years earlier to that, we went to Oakbank, a bit of a father-son day, and we'd had a great day. Cars parked right up on the hill. Righto, you get a bit boisterous, let's have a bit of a race. A couple of fences to jump. So of course, Dad's not competitive. Off he took. We sort of thought we were going to do it, maybe, but no, he was serious. He got to the last jump. He's a good 20 metres in front, and he's flying, and he just misjudged it. He jumped too early, came down, ripped all his pants, a few scratches and that, and he sort of looked, oh, got up to me, okay. He thought all he was worried about, what's Beryl going to say? But he had that worked out. He went home. Behind his door, he had all his clothes. He put it right up underneath. And Mum never found it for a week. The trouble was gone. Just another time, we'd gone to another carbine lunch with Richard Jolly's crew, and we went up to 2KW, which is a bar and restaurant, North Terrace, King William Street. Probably not the sort of place Dad would ever go. But he's in. Have to go up two sets of lifts. And we're up there, we're having a good time. Poor old Brad, again, downstairs. Yeah, we won't be long. Probably, you know, six or seven. And where's Dad? He's gone. About an hour later, he's appeared. He'd been up with the owner of the whole place in the penthouse above, in his house. Getting shown around, this is Woody, looking at the views. Had a hell of a time with him. Came back down, and obviously we're all talking about that. Time got away from us. Instead of a 5 p.m. departure, it's midnight. But it was, like, just fantastic. I don't know whether it was that trip or another trip on the way home. This is the last story of his face. He looked around at me. He's in the Land Cruiser. And he's having a Jim Beam and cola, like Dad was a beer man. And he's taking it back. And he looked around at me. He says, Craig, how long have they been selling these for? He said, that's beautiful. About 20 years, Dad. But, you know, we talk about, and I hear us call him Murray, but the respect, that's the part he started. It all just happened as kids, I reckon. I reckon he gave us all the respect ingredients, and then we baked the cake. He helped us bake the cake of respect. So in those early days, I don't know, just an early teenager, I was calling him Murray. Like, everyone, you think it's Dad, but I know now it was at that time that he was starting us as mates, as really close mates, as well as his dad. And that came right through the last day. So, Chrissy, I won't touch much more on it, but it's amazing now to reflect on how he gave us all those skills and confidence and respect and personality and love that we didn't really know it was happening. We only look back now and see exactly what he was doing. One thing I noticed a lot, particularly in the last 6 weeks, we already knew it existed, is his ability to assess a person in seconds. He's got them sussed out straight away. And it's nothing mean, but it's amazing accuracy. Those nurses, from nurses to footballers, but the nurses, they would come in and all say, gee, she's a nice nurse, Dad. No, she's sort of, she's a bit forgetful. She's supposed to go and get something. She doesn't come back. Okay, so then later on that day, yeah, she was supposed to go and do this and she hadn't come back with it. He goes, Tom. But yeah, he would be out there assessing footballers with Paul and I, and he was a proud Crows and a proud Yank Tigers man, as a player, a supporter and on the committee. But probably his proudest day, I reckon, still see the look on his face when his four grandsons played A grade at Wollonga. Yeah, that was good to watch. Good to see him so proud. He still talked about that to the last minute. And watching Deb and Chris with the netball, he was always there too. One thing he did mention to me though, deflated me a bit, but he said, you know, if Debbie was a boy, she was a man, she'd be playing AFL now and Aaron Phillips would never have won any medals. He was very proud of your long drop kick competition, Debbie. His footy, he was fast, but sometimes too fast. They kept telling us. Richard Crozier told me a story in a grand final. He stood a Sturt League man that had just come down and he stopped him. He was very proud of that and we won the grand final that day. After footy, obviously, we've all touched on a bit, was the horse racing, which was pretty dear to all our hearts. And I describe Dad, there's no question, he is a horseman. It's not something we should use lightly because he was a real horseman. And what I've seen since Dad's days with the horses to now, I know he was. He was just so unique. He, as Norm said, he developed his own ways to achieve. One that always sticks in my head when we get to the races. He had, it's off the cups in the milk shed, this rubber, it was an inflation. And when we'd get to the races, if the horse wanted a drink, yeah, we'd go to where the others have a drink, but he'd put this inflation over the hose so that our horses couldn't touch the same hose as other horses and they wouldn't get a cold. He protected them in every way. And as Norm said, the string, the rubber, the wire, he found ways of looking after me. Sewed up all his own rugs, those Hessian rugs, to cool them down. They had to be right. And the canvas ones, he repaired all them. It was just a part of his way. He'd do all his own track work. Right up until a horse had to do fast work, he was riding them well into his 50s. When he was first starting them off, he would be gone for 30 to 50 minutes, just walking and trotting them, getting them fit. Handling horses for Dad, we might look at it and say, God, it's so time consuming and slow. But that was the way he did it. He was never in a hurry. He made sure everyone was treated right. And race day, as Chris touched on, seeing Dad all dressed up, coming out with his, he'd get in the back door and he'd put this stinky old pair of overalls on. Because the horses couldn't see him coming up to the stables on race day, late morning. That horse would know it's going to races. But he'd go up in the overalls and they'd just think he's going up to do something. We'd have to put the car and float out a good hour or two before. You can't be here, and the horse can't be here, and the float in the car getting into position. They'll get too pumped up, we won't load them. He just knew what to sense, and he used to have everything as calm as he could. Starting off his horses, he bought one for £20, Lady Oram, and he bred everything out of that. And everything followed on from that. So, it's pretty unique to breed them. You know, to raise them, to train them, to own them, just doesn't happen anymore. We chatted recently about his his favourite horse, and he said he couldn't split them. Sonny Joanne and Tumbling, they won 21 races between them. Oh, they gave us some incredible joy. A lot of city races. Genetics is a marvellous thing, I always say. And now I love it, Norm loves it, the kids love it, we all love it. Thanks, Dad. But the one, probably the most special part of the racing bit is the exhilaration that we had with him. To be in the stands with him at Victoria Park, his old stands in Cheltenham and Morphville, and then the horse wins. And unless you've been in that situation with a family, with people you're really close to, it's pretty hard to explain that feeling. And then for us to be able to turn that around, and Louis and Norm and I, we had a horse rocking Joe at Moonee Valley, and Mum and Dad, it was just Norm and I. Poor Lou couldn't come, he got stuck at Ballarat. And Mum and Dad were there with us that day. I'll never ever forget that. That feeling you just cannot describe. We were so proud for Mum and Dad to be there, but that inner feeling, I still struggle to explain to anybody else that hasn't been there what it does feel like. Yeah, we're the lucky family. It's already been touched on. 20 years of family holidays with the Chief. Yeah, they won't be the same, but he'll be there in spirit. Just trying to finish up. Me personally, to tell a story that associates, I think, our relationship. I was 4 years old. We were all taught, probably at about four, to drive. Our legs weren't quite long enough. I couldn't touch the pedals, but we could steer. And on this day, wet, thundery day, I'm steering the tractor, going into the next paddock, and Dad would jump off. And as we know, all these gates are wired up, and they got barbed wire here, the old cocky style gate. And I'm headed for the gate, and he can't get it open. So there's not enough time for him to come to me. So I've just veered off to the left, straight through the strainer post, straight through into the fence, until it stopped the tractor. He didn't tell me off. I'm pretty sure he didn't. Oh, I was only four, but I'm very sure he didn't tell me off. He took me back to Mum. I can remember this bit. The fire was going, and I sat there, and I was waiting, and nothing. He looked at me, and then he just went off. He fixed all the fence, sorted the tractor out, never told anybody for a week. That's the bond. I look back now, and know and understand how special that was. But now, Dad, as Norm said, you're knocking on the pearly gates. I can just see him rocking up with a report card. English, C, maths, C plus, art, D minus, and a comment, absolutely no interest at all. Farmer, an A. Horse trainer, an A. Slang and giving nicknames, A plus. Yodeling, A plus. As a mate, as a great-grandfather, grandfather, husband and dad, he's A double plus. The last thing that, the strength of your love, never been probably outwardly able to talk about it like this, but the strength of your love and the family love that you gave us as a group, I don't know about any other family, but I know how incredibly strong ours is. As a result of that, it then gives you so much grief and pain when you leave us. But I would never, ever, ever trade any small part of that love. You're a beauty, Dad. I love you.
Well, just as we thought 2020 couldn't get weird enough, here I am doing this. At least I don't have to have you guys looking at me crying while I talk. I can look out my window and watch an apartment get built. I was lucky enough for Dad to say a few words to Pop on behalf of me. So, Pop, I've told you a lot of the things I've wanted to. I'll just add to it. Thank you, Pop. Thank you for giving all of us in the family the greatest gift of life, and that is love. The power of love that bonds this family is more than most and is cherished by all of us. The love that was provided to me from such a young age that I saw from you and Nana, the example you set, I think has made me the caring, compassionate, successful nurse that I am today. And I truly, words can't thank you enough for that. All them shitty cups of tea we made you in the wrong cup, stirred with the spoon from Nana's milky tea. You did care, but you laughed about it. You were just happy to be drinking your tea with us, happy to be sharing stories and laughs, talking about the crows, how much we hated Port, or about horses or the farm. It was just great to be in your company. The sleepovers we had when all five of us were younger in your bed in the morning. Then you'd tell me off when I did the dishes and I didn't do the bowls first because the plates had to stack on the bowls. It was just your routine. All the sport you watched us play in Jimmy, and that beautiful gold tooth smile that would light up your face whenever you saw us grandkids. Every time we saw that unique grin of yours, it made me realise how proud you are of me and what an honour that was. All the memorable holidays, the family quote of the decade, I think we could say, bugger bulla bulla save me. Not many people my age would consider their Pop one of their greatest friends, but you were to us and you always will be. I know you're looking over all of us right now, so Pop, take a moment, look back at life's journey. I can even feel the overwhelming amount of love that's in that church right now. And I'm not even there, so I'm certain that you are feeling it wherever you are. I love you, Pop. Knowing you're at peace, drinking the perfect black tea with all them animals you cared for and loved makes me know you're definitely in the right place. I love you, Pop. And we'll miss you. And I miss you all sitting in that church right now. I'm sending you all my love. You guys are also my heroes. Thank you. Miss you, and I cannot wait to give you all the biggest hug I can possibly give. Love you all.
Now, as I said,
Pick up the book, you show your voice, lift it up off the table.
No, I didn't. He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all, how will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather, was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor present things nor future things nor powers nor height nor depth nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God, Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
I want you to know that I spent quite a few hours preparing those readings, and I sent off an email on the reading for the day. They didn't reach me yet. And there's somebody around South Australia who unexpectedly has received funeral readings. And here's something you probably can't do. You hear about Jesus in church, and it's quiet, and usually, you know, the reading's not that exciting. I can remember when I was three, my earliest memories. I knew you wouldn't have taught in church, so I stretched out a little clip, but I slapped on the legs. So I thought, if I'd known about Muslims, I might have joined up then, because there's something wrong with that, but I'm too repressed. But in fact, in Jesus' own life, he wasn't a church person. I mean, he went to church on the Sabbath day. But he knocked around with the racing crowd. He must have done. Remember, they complained about him. He was always having parties. He was the Fitzgeralds are pretty correct and proper, but Jesus used to knock around with prostitutes and with people who were dealing with the occupying power. And you almost have to unlearn a lifetime of Jesus at church, because here's a little story. And Jesus will give you kind of a clue. Two things. He went back over the past. So where did it begin? What was the beginning of the story? And then what? So sometimes people say to me, look, this idea of life after death, nobody's ever come back. But if you spoke to twins in the womb, would you imagine the skeptic little twin saying, this is as good as it gets, nobody's ever come back? We can't imagine anything, well, you couldn't, beyond the womb. And life as it is, as we know it, is totally unimaginable. What we believe as Christians is that God's got a surprise party in mind. If we go put a surprise party for the children, we do a pretty good job, don't we? We've got things you can do for bringing out the best in this. And if God sets out to give Maury a surprise party, it'll be some party. And here's what he said. And this is, Jesus didn't ever say too much in Lord Britain's stories. He said, when the Son of Man comes in glory, and all the angels with him, he'll sit on his throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him, and he'll separate them one from the other, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He'll place the sheep on his right, and the goats on his left. And then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from when? There's an early minute for anybody to remember the next words. He said, prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Jesus, through the whole of evolution and history, was leading to Maury, to each of us at Bloom, that had a long history of preparation. And all of his life, we talked about so beautifully. He said, the reason that you qualify, you know that winning excitement you're talking about, it's hard to beat that feeling. Well, Jesus said, that's what it's like at the final finishing post. He said, I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I drove the tractor to the fence and you didn't drop me in. That Jesus lived in that world of the, he wasn't a priest, he wasn't a policeman. He was a worker, what they called a technos. He was the all-round builder in the village. And he would have worked at a big Greek town being built, just down the road from this place. It was a knockabout world. And he said, I was ill and you cared for me. I was in prison and you visited me. And then Maury's going to answer him and say, Lord, I think you got the fires mixed. He said, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or see you drive a tractor into a fence? All the nice things he just spoke about that Maury did. When do we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When we are, I don't think we've met before, the Lord did, but when did we see you in or in prison and visit you? And the king will say to him in reply, Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these, you did for me. Now that's a lovely story to tell. Jesus said, Jesus so identifies with us, the way you've identified today with Maury. That's how our Jesus said, God identifies with us. And all those things that Maury did, we think that's a tremendous, it is, it's just a tremendous life. But imagine if we find that, that God is not a church person, if we find that God actually made Maury, and all that instinct, that heart, that mind, that wisdom, all of that is a reflection of God. But God is Maury plus, I think. It takes a lot of unlearning for that. But that dear, that's some sort of thoughts about God is turning on a surprise party. And Maury is now getting ready a surprise party for all of us when we join him. Now we're going to have some prayers of the faithful, which were on that bit of paper that's gone to somebody else, but we've worked out ourselves. Here we go. Oh, here we go. There's only scratching in the grace. Here we go. I once went to the wrong person in hospital. It was late at night, at 2 a.m. A lot of them were gone from the Adelaide now. It used to be post-op. And I went down on my motorbike as a young priest, and sister said, the patient's had a relapse, won't last till the morning. Sent me to the end of the road of this aisle, and there was a patient away. And I broke the sad news to him that he was dying. And that was the wrong patient. I went back, and I wasn't too impressed with the sister who sent me there, but I still worry about that man who thought that I'd come to give him a nervous breakdown. Here's some of the prayers. And these are prayers that we make together, special occasion God listens to us. These are, to each of these, they end with, Lord, oh, we praise the Lord, but we answer, Lord, hear our prayer. Can you say that? Lord, hear our prayer?
You raise the dead of life. Give to our brother, sister, eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, what do you think from us?
Comfort us in our sorrow at the death of our Maury. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
This is for not just for ourselves now, but there are a lot of people around the world grieving in different things.
Let us pray for those who mourn. Comfort them in their grief. Lord, in your mercy.
Lord, hear our prayer.
This is especially for Murray.
Welcome them into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And there's a special prayer of a farewell. We'll do a better job than we did. When my brother died, he was a fairly high rank in the Air Force. He was a group captain. And his son was a group captain. When my brother died, he was cremated. And his son flew a small plane out over the Pacific. He lived on the Gold Coast. And he flew out over the Pacific, the sun's eye, and he sprinkled his ashes over the Pacific. But he didn't allow for the slipstream. They all blew straight back into the back of the plane. And my brother's been flying a small plane ever since. So I want to get the ending right. Here's a special prayer. We might start with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth
as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Lord, in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, to our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend Murray to Almighty God. And we commit him to the elements, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face shine on him and be gracious to him. The Lord lift up his countenance upon him and give him peace. And a prayer for ourselves. We bow our heads and we ask for God's blessing. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of people who grieve at a loss. And you pay attention to the prayers of those who ask. Hear your people who call to you now in their need. Strengthen our hope in your lasting goodness. This we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Eternal rest run unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen.
Amen.
May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody we've left out? There. Coming through, all right, okay.
Toast to the ones that we lost on the way, cause the dreams Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes the service here today for Molly Fitzgerald. Once again, on behalf of his family, a big thank you, huge thank you to Father Bob for coming out of retirement to join us here today. I believe he walked all the way from Adelaide, no company car. In a few moments, we're going to escort the coffin out to the hearse where the family will join us in their own private farewell for Molly. We'll then be making our way up to the Lynx Lady Bay, where everyone who's watching up there is invited to join us by coming out and placing a floral tribute on his coffin. The family will then be making their way inside to join you all for some light refreshments, I believe. Thank you. Now, can I please have the pallbearers come forward? Thank you.
Thank you.